Hachette Audio presents Boom, Mad Money, Mega Dealers, and the Rise of Contemporary Art. Written by Michael Shnayerson. Read by Jonathan Davis. For Gayfrid. Author's note. Contemporary art is a hard subject to get your arms around these days. Artists rise and sometimes fall in a few years. Some do work that is clearly gorgeous. Others make off-putting, head-scratching, shocking, or even viscerally appalling work. There are many books, magazines, journals, and blogs that debate the relative merits of contemporary artists and the lasting value of their work. That is not the purpose of this audiobook. I have happily yielded that task to the curators and critics. I have looked instead for the story of how the market for contemporary art evolved from rather modest and uncertain beginnings in the 1940s to become a wildly unpredictable financial roller coaster in the present, with global reach, capable of making and moving vast fortunes, and with the lightest regulatory touch of any financial market in the world. Perhaps inevitably, such an environment has attracted a vivid cast of characters, some with aristocratic fortunes behind them, others utterly self-made. It mixes European hauteur with American moxie. It's a space where women have had, if not quite an absolutely equal footing to the men, then a crucial role in the lives and careers of some artists, and have been innovators and trailblazers to a degree unseen in any other comparable business environment. Perhaps Peggy Guggenheim's presence at the creation of the contemporary art story ensured it would never be an all-boys club story. My hope is that listeners will enjoy the audiobook not only for the glimpses of some of the most memorable works of the last half century, but for the stories of the men and women who toiled over them, sponsored them, talked them up, and in some cases, even bid them up. John Kassman, a leading dealer for decades, once sized up his role with a bit of cheek. All artists do is produce the work. The dealer has to create its allure, he declared, and then added, rather a silly remark, but it's not completely untrue. Indeed, it's not. Prologue. The Kings and Their Court, 2017. At 6 p.m. on a warm June Sunday evening in Basel, Switzerland, the terrace of the Grand Hôtel Le Trois Rois, overlooking the Rhine River, seemed as quiet and pristine as the city itself, a study in Swissness. In 2 days, Art Basel, the annual bellwether fair for the business of modern and contemporary art, would begin, drawing the world's best-known dealers and collectors into a whirl of 6, 7, and even a few 8-figure sales of works by artists alive and dead. But on the terrace that served as the elite social hub of the fair, there was, so far, no hint of the crowds to come. As the terrace slowly filled, half a dozen new arrivals slid down either side of a refectory table. The host of this group sat with his back to most of the hotel's other guests, but there was no mistaking him, with his head of short-cropped silvery hair and commanding presence. Larry Gagosian, the world's most powerful art dealer, had arrived. There was a time when Gagosian did not come to Art Basel. He shunned crowds when he could. Notoriously aggressive in business, he preferred not to mingle if he could help it. But he had warmed to the fair, as he put it, and now was a fixture. Gagosian was among close friends that evening. Across from him was Dasha Zhukova, the soon-to-be ex-wife of Russian oligarch Roman Abramovich. Zhukova was an art world celebrity in her own right, both as a collector and as the founder of Moscow's Garage Museum of Contemporary Art. Here, too, were Alberto Tico Mugrabi and his brother David, both second-generation collector-dealers. Their father, Yosef Jose Mugrabi, a Colombian textile importer of Syrian Jewish descent, had come to Art Basel in 1987 on a lark and had an epiphany. Despite knowing nothing about the painter, the elder Mughrabi paid $144,000 for four Andy Warhol panels depicting Leonardo da Vinci's Last Supper, just months after Warhol's death. Soon enough, they began rising in value. The lesson Mughrabi took from this acquisition was not to become an art collector. It was to buy every Warhol of quality he could. As the family's art holdings grew, he seemed to delight in bidding up Warhols at auction to increase their market value. Why not? The more expensive each newly acquired Warhol was, the more valuable many of the Mughrabi's other Warhols might become. As of this moment in June 2017, Jose Mughrabi and his sons reputedly owned more than 800 Warhols. Proudly, they called themselves market makers. Their buying and selling activities did affect the Warhol market, helping make him one of the best-selling artists in the world. Theirs was a business in which millionaires and billionaires bought up the works of top artists, stored them in vast temperature-controlled warehouses within so-called free ports, and then, if they liked, sold them tax-free to other collectors. Tax-free, as long as the art stayed in the free port's protective cocoon. The art to be sold at Art Basel in 48 hours' time was mostly, though not all, contemporary, which was to say, it had been made by artists who had started their careers after World War II, as opposed to modern art created by artists who had started before the war. The nomenclature could get a little tricky. Picasso was a modern artist even though he had painted until his death in 1973. The deciding factor was the start date for his career, decades before World War II. As time passed, the best works by the most celebrated modern artists grew ever scarcer and more expensive, as did those by top post-war artists. As the ranks of wealthy collectors grew, so did demand for even the latest contemporary artists. No one played to that yen to acquire better than Larry Gagosian, whose roster of artists included more giants of both modern and contemporary art than any other dealer. Gagosian had flown to Basel on a $60 million Bombardier Global Express jet 2 days before the fair's first choice VIP preview. He liked checking in early at Le Trois Rois. He felt it gave him a head start. Space at the hotel was so tight that Gagosian's entourage had to sleep elsewhere. Only the king got a room at the Three Kings. Most other dealers would arrive on Monday, a day before the fair's coveted VIP opening. A few, like silver-haired blue-chip dealer Bill Aquavella, would arrive in their own planes. Others would descend at Basel's Euro Airport in net jets, filled with collectors and money, like an art world air force. Many dealers had sent images of works from their fair inventories to clients, and many of those works had been put on reserve. Some 35 years before, Gagosian had earned scorn in Soho for showing photographs or transparencies of paintings that weren't always his to sell. There wasn't anything illegal about that, nor was he the first to do it. Gagosian was just drumming up interest in a painting he'd seen somewhere, perhaps on someone's living room wall. Today, images flew across the internet from dealers to collectors, to say nothing of the advisors, assistants, and everyone in between in the art world food chain. From his table on the terrace, Gagosian occasionally looked out over the Rhine to the river's far bank. His profile was a bit rounder than it once was, though set on the still broad shoulders of a former athlete. In the lingering heat, swimmers jumped from a dock into the Rhine's fast-moving current, bobbed downriver a stretch, then clambered up onto the shore to jump again. At his public high school in Southern California, Gagosian had been a competitive swimmer. Freestyle and backstroke were his strengths, and earned a serious ranking. Then at the University of California, Los Angeles, he'd seen his position plummet. There were just too many strong swimmers at UCLA. For some years after graduating with a BA in English Literature, he had drifted from one humdrum job to the next. And then, like Jose Mugrabi, he had an epiphany about art. In his case, that he could sell it. Half an hour later, the terrace group stood to go. Gagosian, in a uniform of dark blue linen and black rubber-soled Loro Piana moccasins, the ne plus ultra of slip-ons, padded off with a panther-like gait into a waiting Mercedes. Ironically, he was now one of the few dealers at Art Basel who didn't try to pre-sell most of his art before the fair by sending out images. "I don't like that approach," he would say later. "I like to see the action." Competition was always keen among the nearly 300 exhibitors coming to Art Basel. It was perhaps sharpest among the four mega-dealers whose sales far outdid the others. David Zwirner of the Zwirner Gallery, Ewan Wirth of Hauser & Wirth, Arnie Glimpscher and his son Mark of Pace Gallery, and Gagosian. These were galleries with annual sales in the hundreds of millions of dollars. Gagosian was reputed to gross the most, roughly $1 billion a year. The others were said to be closer to $250 million each, but claimed to do better, far better than that. Arnie and Mark Glimpscher purported in 2017 to be on their way to their best year ever. When it ended, they would say they had broken the $1 billion threshold and outperformed Gagosian himself. Who knew? All four mega dealers' galleries were private, their profit reports tightly held. For an hour or so before the doors opened on Tuesday morning, the VIP fairgoers milled in the round, open-air center of Basel's Mezzoplatz, drinking champagne and greeting old friends. Almost every woman carried a high-end designer bag. Almost every man sported a loose linen jacket or suit, sans tie. Despite the hugs and air kisses, a sense of urgency and competition pulsed just below the surface. These weren't merely VIPs. They were the highest echelon of VIPs, as their timed entrance tags disclosed. No one rushed the doors when they opened at 11 a.m., but within 3 or 4 minutes the attendees had all glided inside, headed for the booths of their favorite dealers. Many were famous in this rarefied world.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.